So, how does this work? What do you do? How to implement this? Well, let's go at it one piece at a time. The original research came to Kevin Anders Anderson, Kevin Anders Ericsson, after he started studying memory. Now, his discovery was, or his surprise was, that while people had different memory skills, they could actually improve tremendously in a short time. One of his favorite students was someone who started off with the standard short-term memory of 7 plus minus 2, so being able to take in from 5 to 9 pieces of information, which is the standard short-term memory amount, and he moved on to being able to remember incredibly complex numbers very easily and very quickly. Now, this was just a couple of weeks of work for him, and he managed this by being an avid long-distance runner fan. So, whenever he had to learn a number, he translated it into times. So, the record time of this or that runner for, let's say, the 1 mile run or the 10 mile run. And he translated the complex pieces of information, complex numbers, into those times which were easier for him to remember. Now, this intrigued Anderson Ericsson, because it was for him quite unusual. Because he considered, okay, so if this guy could improve his memory so much in such a short time, then maybe other people can improve their memories as well. Maybe their memory, the short-term memory skills aren't actually inborn, they are trained. And his later research showed that actually a lot of things that we considered inborn are actually trained. There are skills that people gain over a long time of practice, and they are not born or designed with them. There is, at least on the expert level, no innate talent, no inborn talent. There is only hard work and the appropriate use of so-called deliberate practice. Now, I hate the name, I'll tell you later why I hate the name, but for now, what he did was to go to the West Berlin Academy of Music and to study those people who were studying there. And he had three groups that he paid attention to. The people who the teachers were considered to be the best students, so the ones who had the most promise, who they were considering to be future international stars. The people who the teachers were considered, okay, but local level musicians. And as a control group, he took a group of students from the music's teacher class. Now, the music's teacher class was actually far less skilled, and these were the people who weren't supposed to be professional players, just people who were supposed to teach music. And he started to study the differences between those three groups. What made the best people the best, and what made the worst the worst. What made the best people the best and what made the worst the worst? Now, the differences were a bit surprising, because as it turned out, none of the good or bad students seemed to be those who were born with a great talent. All of them started to learn at pretty much the same age, about the age of five, and none of them considered music to be their calling as such. Usually it was only about their 15th birthday that they decided to actually devote their career to music. And they pretty much even trained the same time. But the difference, as Ericsson found, was that whenever they trained, the average students and the poor students used to train by playing for pleasure, while the best student paid a lot of time to individual practice, practicing the hardest part of the scores, giving the most effort and attention to it. Now that individual practice was rated by the students as absolutely the hardest thing they were doing in their lives. Harder than babysitting, harder than any housework, harder than any employment. This was the most time and effort and skill consuming part of their day. But the more you did it, the better you were, and there were no exceptions.